For the past 8 years, I've been a researcher at the intersection of artificial intelligence and space technology. So I'm well practiced at answering questions like, was the moon landing fake, and is AI going to destroy the world? For the record, the answer to both of those questions is no. When I was a satellite operator, it was my responsibility to send the commands that controlled spacecraft orbiting Earth. Objectively, the coolest job ever. At the time, I was responsible for the world's largest fleet of Earth imaging spacecraft, hundreds of satellites. And every day, thousands of gigabytes of data was transmitted down from space in the form of spacecraft telemetry and pictures of our planet. I would parse through this data to make sure everything was running smoothly. To help decipher the health and productivity of our satellites, my team used AI algorithms for anomaly detection, an automatic way to identify which spacecraft were having issues and what was their likely problem. And this helped us quickly diagnose, triage, and solve any problems and successfully complete our mission of providing accurate, timely images of our planet. And it was in satellite operations, looking at incredible pictures of Earth every day, creating the data that could be used for things like natural disaster response and climate change monitoring, that I knew the most important use of Earth observation data was to combat climate change, and the best way we could do that could be with AI. And so I applied to the PhD program that would allow me to explore just that, and here I am today. So back down on Earth, I now work at the other end of the pipeline, using satellite data and AI for humanitarian capacity building, disaster preparedness, and climate change. The AI I'm building is being used in Nepal to forecast monsoonal landslides, deadly events that can impact hundreds of thousands of lives and result in tens of millions of dollars in damage to critical infrastructure. With AI, we can provide information to the government to assist with early warning of these disasters to save lives. With the NASA Jet Propulsion Lab, I've been using AI to model air pollution, with the ultimate goal to understand its main drivers to inform future environmental policy. And most recently, with the United Nations and European Space Agency, I've been using AI to map internet infrastructure in the Global South, a part of the GIGA initiative, aimed at connecting every school to the internet and every young person to information, opportunity, and choice. But why is AI a suitable tool for satellite operations, modeling the climate, predicting landslides, or helping society at all? The power of this tool lies in its fantastical ability to ingest, synthesize, and make sense of enormous amounts of data in a way impossible for any human to achieve quickly and correctly. I know a lot of us have probably heard of the term of AI, whereas the definition can be a bit hazy. So to get everyone on the same page today, AI can be thought of as the science of making machines think like humans and achieve tasks that require otherwise human-level intelligence. And while landsliding or satellite operations may not personally impact every member of the audience, now more than ever, artificial intelligence technology touches every facet of our lives. You might think you're outside of its reach, but it's virtually impossible in modern Western society not to be impacted by it in some way. It's choosing which ads we see. It's in our homes with personal assistants like Siri and Alexa. It's providing us with customer support when a package is stolen or a delivery is late. It even helped me navigate to this auditorium to deliver this talk. I remember growing up in the early 2000s, printing out the directions to my out-of-town soccer games from MapQuest.com, intensely staring at the pages and pages of instructions, ensuring we didn't miss a turn or exit off the 401, else we'd be lost in a rural Ontario suburb for the next 20 minutes until we finally made our way back onto the highway. And nowadays, I take the AI-generated directions from the Maps app on my phone as a challenge, trying to safely beat the ETA by 1 to 2 minutes without it ever occurring to me if I should trust the directions given. I simply accept, follow, and I'm led to my destination. Engaging with AI in modern society is no longer a matter of choice. It's already seamlessly being integrated into all areas of our lives to the point we don't even notice we're adopting, and even more so, relying on it. And as users of this tech, it's critical we engage with it safely and ethically. But this is tough, right? I mean, think about it. Do you cross-reference the directions results you get from Google Maps with physical maps and other resources to make sure the directions are correct and true? Well, no. Then why should you or I care about the output from an AI chatbot or any other AI-generated tech for that matter? Because while this technology has the potential to create powerful, impactful products for good, it can also create and perpetuate societal harm. And as an AI researcher myself, my passivity to the potential harm this technology can cause is unacceptable and, frankly, unethical. So today, I want to help you become a conscious consumer of AI. And as this year's TEDxQueensU theme of Illuminate suggests, I want to help make the so-called black box of AI a little more transparent, highlighting the good and not so good aspects of AI that are often overshadowed by AI model performance of classifying cat pictures. That's mine, by the way. We're writing math exams. Well, there have been incredible things that have been achieved with AI, which has even garnered it worthy of a Nobel Prize. It's not a one-size-fits-all solution or a band-aid fix to any problem. AI won't save us, but it can help us. So let's start at the beginning. Who is building AI? We've heard of the big names in Silicon Valley building these massive AI language models that can seemingly answer any and all of our questions. And a part of building these models is ensuring they're safe and won't cause harm to their users by, for example, providing racist or sexist answers to user queries. And to do this, these models require large data sets of labeled text, video, imagery, so that we can teach the model what is a good or positive sample and what is a bad or negative sample. AI does not exist without data. And data doesn't exist without humans. So AI does not exist without us. And for some of the largest companies in the world, it can be the labor of grossly underpaid content labelers, moderators, and AI workers in the global south responsible for making this tech safe. These workers can spend hours reading horrific passages of text and watching disturbing video and imagery resulting in psychological trauma and stress. And these practices are supposed to make the tech safe for our use, which doesn't exactly feel ethical to me. While we tend to think of AI as this highly technical black box created by the academic elite, which is also sometimes true, it can equally be the product of traumatized workers. Fighting for labor rights and labor advocacy needs to extend beyond North America and Europe, but globally. We also need to think about whose voices are included in the design and development of this tech and what this means. Bias. AI is biased because humans are biased. And bias can originate from a variety of sources. It can come from the data itself, model development, how it's evaluated. I'm going to focus on developmental aspects of bias injection into AI. If we're building these tools with the intention to help others, it's critical we include the voices we're working to help. But according to the 2023 World Economic Forum Gender Report, only 30% of the roles in AI are held by women. And gender misrepresentation, it's only one facet. Diversity of sexual orientation, race, religion, ability, socioeconomic status, these are all important misrepresentations that can be misconstrued by AI. And we know bias in AI causes harm because we've already seen it happen. I live in the UK, so let's take the recent example of the AI system used in the UK to detect benefits fraud, which found bias in using nationality, marital status, age, and disability when informing the government whom to investigate for fraud. There's also the environmental impact of AI to consider. Large-scale AI deployments like ChatGPT or generative AI use data centers for their compute infrastructure. And these data centers come at a high cost to our planet, requiring hundreds of kilograms of raw material for physical hardware, use rare earth elements for microchips that are often mined in environmentally destructive ways and produce electronic waste, and consume enormous amounts of energy. It's been estimated that the yearly projected energy consumption of ChatGPT could power over 21,000 homes in the United States for an entire year. Or it can run the country of Belgium or Finland for an entire day. And a single conversation with ChatGPT consumes the equivalent of a single plastic water bottle's worth of water. Okay, so I started with highlighting some of the positives of AI. I've definitely covered the negatives, and it can all feel a bit overwhelming. So how can we, as users, be conscious consumers of AI? Conscious consumerism starts with curiosity, awareness, and education. Everyone in this room should use the tech. Even as a researcher working 60 plus hours a week in the domain, the AI field is moving faster than I can keep up. It's naive to think you can ignore AI, and frankly, you're going to fall behind if you're not using it. Your classmates are using it, your teachers are using it, your coworkers are using it. And while not everyone in this room will be an AI developer, everyone in this room will be an AI user. When technology is shaping our healthcare, education, politics, and ultimately our society, it's up to us to hold ourselves accountable and consciously interacting with it. And we can use the principles of deconstruction as a starting point. So curiosity and asking questions like, what data was used to train this model? And are the references and resources provided by a chatbot's output valid, correct, true? Awareness can be the knowledge of what factors and technology is my government using to assess me as a citizen and individual in accessing resources like healthcare, benefits, unemployment. Is this fair? Education is understanding that AI is, and will continue to, make our lives easier. But this comes at a price, impacting our planet's health and the livelihoods of others. I've been lucky enough to work at the intersection of two of the coolest fields, AI and space, and use them to help others. And actually, the longer I've been in this field, the stronger my conviction grows that no, AI will not destroy us all, and no, AI can't solve all of our problems. However, it is an incredible tool that we can use to help ourselves and others. AI has the potential to change the world for the better. Let's make sure it's not causing more harm at the same time. Thank you.